LARPers. Are they really a bunch of nerds who run around screaming, lightning bolt, to cope with how out of touch from reality they are? I'm Anthony Padilla, and I'm gonna find out the truth from live action role players themselves.
Hello, Zach.
Hello.
Raquel Skellington.
Hi, it's nice to meet you.
Tab.
Hey, hey.
This episode is sponsored by BetterHelp Online Therapy. Visit betterhelp.com/Padilla because sometimes existing is exhausting. Now, you look like you LARP.
Yes, I do in fact LARP full time.
Is that a fair assessment?
Yes.
There are a couple giveaways.
Oh, yeah, really?
Do I look like someone who LARPs?
Yeah, you do.
Yeah?
You do, actually.
Oh, really? Why?
Actually, the fashion is strong in the LARP community.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. Oh,
are you dressed up as your character,
no.
A character?
I'm dressed up as Tab.
Tab.
Yeah, it's a guy that I play since I was born, and yeah.
I have been LARPing for like 3 years. It's a buffer-style LARP, which means it's a lot of combat as well as role play. Clearly, there's some magic.
Some magic is happening right here, if I do say so myself.
A lot of arcane detritus.
Mean, you got a spell bottle.
Oh, yeah. This is potion, but it's also...
Not a spell bottle, potion, very different.
This
okay.
This is just a hydration potion.
Oh, wait, do you literally just drink that when you're out there on the fields? Does it make a sound? Ooh.
Ooh.
Mmm. What is this live-action role-playing that I hear about?
LARPing is essentially just playing pretend.
Mm-hmm.
Like, just to keep it super simple, it's all about, like, a bunch of adults getting into a space, agreeing on a time period or a theme, and then just doing the pretend. That's all it is.
So it's having fun?
Yes, it's having a lot of fun.
Who are you dressed up as today?
Excellent. So my character is, you want the full name?
Oh, yes.
Okay, so it is.
Why do you look like it's,
yes.
Well, it looks like it has difficulty coming off of your tongue.
There's just a lot there. There's a lot to cover.
Okay, so slowly for
okay,
me.
Okay, so I play Sevius Maya, the Turning Stone, child of Zipporah and Symphon Maya, first of her name of the tribe Rattaland. But Sevius is fine.
That haunts me. Sevius Tremora, house of the name Marfama.
Yes. If someone repeats that name back to me, I assume that they are like my soulmate.
So when I was doing research for this episode and I went on Google and I said LARP, I feel like it didn't really quite get into what it is. Surface level, people hit each other.
Correct.
Bang, bang, slap, slap, one person dead.
Mm.
That's really it. That's really all I got.
Oh, yeah.
How accurate is that? Oh, yeah, lightning bolts.
Okay, yes, there are a lot of those. Uh-huh. I was actually struck by, well, my character was struck by lightning this weekend, but that's...
Oh, did it hurt?
Yes.
Do you think that video that went viral kind of cast a negative light or made LARPing look silly?
Man, any publicity is good publicity,
you
know? And even if they're poking fun, there's somebody that's like, I'd like to do that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, heck, I'd like to do that with my kids.
Right.
You know, going out and playing, do people really do that much anymore?
Not over the age of 5.
Exactly, exactly.
No, your eyes need to be glued to your iPad and you need to be swiping. Explain what it is that you do when you make one of your shows.
So when I produce a show, it starts at the very end of the last show.
Okay, so it's a continuous story.
Yes.
Kind of like the Dream SMP.
Okay, I don't know what that is.
You don't have to.
Fair enough. I have 33 acres in Tennessee that I've been developing for, this is year 6 now.
Yeah.
We started with a shack and nothing and 6 people that wanted to try this game.
Mm.
The way that we produce our shows is like a TV show. So a chapter, my whole organization is the series, right?
Mm.
Each year is a season. Each weekend is an episode. So you have your episode arc, your season arc, and the whole story of, you know, the Game of Thrones, you know,
right.
Whatever the main arc is. We make sure that we touch on each of those points with the storyline. We use what players were there the previous game and what they did to set up what the next game will be. So if you are coming to your first game, you should probably NPC.
Okay, meaning?
That means being a bad guy and working for me or whatever the game producer is. I will give you a really fast safety fight training. I use that time to read everybody's body language, see if there's any, you know, physicality things that I have to watch out for. Is anybody being ultra aggressive and back them off? Is somebody being triggered? And I have to make sure that, okay, if getting hit with these is not your thing, we have a whole other side of the game. Then you come backstage, into my backstage, which I have walls of costumes and masks, and we have a script for the weekend. Then I sit everybody down, or my head of plot, India, she's a wonderful lady. She sits them down, and basically lays out the story of the weekend. Okay, guys, we're gonna do this, 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 and this. It's your show list. So you're gonna be in this costume, this costume, this costume. We're gonna play all these bad guys throughout the weekend.
It's very theatrical.
Very much so.
Yeah.
I was a theater nerd before I was a gamer nerd. So I always see it from like those moments, those little like, those things that you can tag into a show that brings a show along, those tag moments, and everything else in between doesn't really matter that much. So we write our weekend, we run our weekend. There's usually a big special effects thing, a new prop, whether it's a stilt monster or, you know, the Denver chapter had a 120-foot long worm thing come through town. It's amazing.
So you have some things with us today?
I do. I brought some stuff for you.
Oh.
And we're going to play with it hopefully later. So these are called boffer swords.
Boffer?
Mm-hmm. Boffer, B-O-F-F-E-R, I hope.
Oh, okay, okay.
Oh,
they're light. They're lightweight.
So
they look like it would kind of feel good getting hit by these.
Well, it depends what you're into. I will hand off your weapons to you.
So. Oh, I got two weapons?
Yep, you're gonna have two weapons, but I'm gonna give you
different lengths and girths.
A quick little
only
change.
Length, yep. Same girth.
Light, same girth. Yep.
Yeah.
So the girth is for safety. So
okay.
Go ahead and give me a whap, just like I just gave you a whap.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so the rules of the game, we don't get within arm's contact because accidental punches happen that way, right?
We don't
hit in the head because we're all gorgeous and we want to stay that way. And we don't
want to hit.
And we don't want to hit in the hoo-has because we all want to make more of us.
So, true.
All right.
Do we?
We would be saying things to each other like 4 normal, 5 normal. You do 2 points of damage per dagger swing.
3, 2, 1.
Lay on.
5. You're so quick.
2 normal.
Oh.
2 normal.
Oh.
2
normal. 5 normal.
Got it. 2 normal, 2 normal, 2 normal, 2 normal, 2 normal.
Ah!
So then I would come up and I'd be like killing blow 1, killing blow 2, killing blow 3.
LARPing unfortunately has a massive PR problem because you can't really film it. You can't really capture it in a way where like it's super easy and digestible and marketable because it's super personal.
Yeah.
Like half the LARP is happening in real life, but also in your head. Basically, I would say there's like maybe 6 major styles in the U.S., which would be parlor LARPs, which when you think of like Vampire the Masquerade players, they are the ones that maybe do like rock, paper, scissors, or they roll a dice to do combat, but they're usually like in a coffee shop. And then you have American freeform and American boffer freeform. And that's like the most popular depicted style. Like when you think of LARP, when you think about people in fields like whacking each other and calling out like 333 or like fire, fire, and all that, that is like American classic freeform boffer style.
Oh, this is my character, Alicia. This is her battle gear. She fights actually with a frying pan. I did it before Tangle did it. This character predates that. I asked you to think about, like, who is this guy?
So when I put this on, I decided that my name is Tony the Squire Boy.
I like it.
I'm
You're pretty well dressed for a Squire Boy.
Thank you. I didn't write too much about that part of the story, but I do know that I stole at least 1 to 10 of these items.
Okay, I like that.
Mm-hmm.
That's good motivation. You are projecting your swing. So if I'm gonna hit your right arm, I'm gonna go,
God. Oh, so it is like wrestling in that
yes,
sense.
Yes, it's like WWE.
We know that it's fake.
Yes.
We all know it's fake.
Yes, it's fake.
Yes, of course. Do you not know my status here as a squire?
How dare you approach me as such? Don't you know I'm a diplomat of high standing?
Oh, really? Is that what they call it these days?
Oh, my goodness.
So are you just tapping into your imagination throughout all that?
Yes, a lot of the time it's theater of the mind. The like ceremonies and stuff have like what we call phys reps or physical representations of things. Like this is my character's notebook.
What is in here?
Ah, my book. Okay, so this book is a point of contention in my friend group because they all think that it's bound with human skin. It's not.
Really, that looks like flesh. It really.
It's not. Well, it is. Yeah, it is real leather.
It is flesh, just not human flesh.
Exactly.
Well, is there really any way to know?
No, there is not. I will just say that book is not vegan.
Ooh, this is, you have a spell scroll here.
There's some spells in there that most of them I can talk about. Yeah, I hide my spells in my notebook. You can say, by my voice, stun, which means I, for 3 seconds, have to fall back about 3 steps and cannot attack you. I can't grab anything. I'm stunned for 3 seconds.
And how often can you use it?
Now, it's a skill that's purchased. Essentially, you have a couple of...
Everything costs money in this economy.
Yeah. One.
Oh. One.
Oh, oh my. One.
One. One.
Oh. Oh. And you always want to aim for the legs because no one's arms are as long as their legs.
Right, and they can't block that shit.
Yes, unless they decide to, you know.
Oh, crouching.
Which...
Some people do that.
It's tough because working out between games is not is not great. But yeah, if you've got mega knees, then by all means bring them to the battle.
Oh, I got mega knees. Okay. These knees are never aging.
Oh, well then.
Yeah. I got the knees of a 12-year-old boy.
And you make sure you shout that in battle.
I got the knees of a 12-year-old boy! Is there an official set of rules? Something that everyone goes by? Like they know, go look at the rule Bible.
Yeah, there is a rule book. I have a copy. Mm. Here we are.
So many different rules here. Is everyone expected to know everything?
No, not at all. I would say you're responsible for the kind of character you want to play. So I play a very, like, obviously notebook-driven, lore-driven,
yeah,
spell-casting character.
A lot of knowledge.
Yeah. If you came to me saying you wanted to go, like, LARP with me, we would have a full discussion before you even crack this open, because I want to know, I want to tell you the overall vibe of the world,
mm-hmm,
like first impressions, but I also just want to know like what kind of character you want to play first. Mm-hmm. We'll get into damage 3 and 5 and all that stuff later. Outside of all of the buffering, the running for your life, that's about 20% of it.
Uh-huh.
The other 80% is a lot of honestly making excuses to talk to your friends as other people. And crying about it.
Crying?
A lot of crying.
You do crying when you're in character.
I cry a lot in character.
What things are you crying about?
I cry mostly because my friends are running around dying.
Oh.
And these are people that we have either formed relationships with in-game,
yeah,
or out of game. I've known them for like 200 years. So it becomes a little sad to see them, like, you know, strewn across a battlefield or something.
LARP in general, going out and doing something as a community and unplugging yourself from the troubles that are out there, because there's one or two.
There's a couple things to worry about in the real world.
Especially in the US, for those who aren't here right now watching, yeah. But you know what I don't get asked at a LARP event or a Renaissance Fair event? Who I voted for. Nobody cares.
Mm-hmm.
You know, do I see some stupid hats and some silly t-shirts? Sure. But when everybody is together in something that is creative,
yeah,
and they just let go just a little bit, there is always a chance that they will see a person in someone that was only a label to them previously.
Right.
What I'm seeing, and it's super beautiful because it's in Tennessee.
Yeah.
You know, is very blue collar, mom and dads being cool with their son that wants to dress up like a fairy.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, it's like a safe environment for that to happen.
Yeah, and you know, I know kids that would get their heads boxed for that.
Yeah.
You know, coming up, you know, blue collar on my side of things, it was very normal to be sat down and be told what a man is and what a woman is. And if you can get them in the same room with someone and they're not watching them and they're not watching the label, if you can just get them to share something, and if it's a silly game,
yeah,
all of a sudden that barrier just breaks down. And you know, I've seen it happen because it happened with me. You know, it just has opened up to everyone who plays it what it means to be human and how big that spectrum actually is and how much space there is for all of us to express ourselves if we actually let each other do it. And there's members of the LARP community that I've seen, you know, who were, you know, hard charging, kicking the door soldiers like I was.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But that smile was never there until they became who they were and who they were meant to be. And like, oh, and LARP gave them that little opening of like, it's okay to try that here.
Mm.
It is okay.
You're becoming not necessarily someone else, you're taking aspects of yourself and playing into them. It's a
maybe
trick.
It's an amplified part of you. It's a
yes.
part that you've been suppressing.
Yes.
A part that maybe societally you've been told you should hide?
Yes, I think that's definitely like one aspect of it. Like I used LARP as a way to explore things without commitment. So for instance, I played a gay android who had a girlfriend. And this was before I had come out, even to myself, that I was bisexual. And I played this character and I was like, wow, I really liked this. I really liked being, expressing romantic feelings towards a woman. And then, you know, I talked about it with my friends, and they're like, probably not straight. And I'm like, oh no.
You're like,
oh,
it's
no.
Just in the game, right? Wait.
Oh. LARP is a really, like, it attracts a lot of queer, like, identities and sexualities and lifestyles because it just allows people to either explore them freely, experience them tertiarily by people around them, and not feel judged by it. I know many friends that, like, they played women at LARPs and then later came out as trans. There was no question, oh, you're Pip the Hobbit, right? And it's just like, yeah, that's it. You're Pip the Hobbit.
Right.
And that's
gender wasn't part of the label.
Nope. And that's okay. And that's it. Nobody looks at me and goes, well, you know, that's a black woman in a fancy costume. You know, I'm just Alicia Dura.
Does the space have less black women in it?
We have been on the rise with getting more and more people of color involved in the community. But for a long time, it was like, whew, I was like maybe the only or like one of two like black people in the entire game. And that's mostly because of a lot of boundaries with like financial costs, you know, cultural diversity matters. Like seeing people on screen that look like you matters. And even now, like when people of color just like exist in media and it's not about their trauma about being of color, people like get really mad about that. And there was a huge reaction about that in LARP for a while. But I think we have since kind of grown up and grown past that as a community.
And you know, I can't go without thanking BetterHelp for sponsoring this episode. Therapy has really helped me reframe my view of the world and myself by allowing me to feel empathy for my younger self and therefore understand who I am today better. But therapy can be customized to whatever is right for you and can be useful in helping with things like motivation or feelings of depression, anxiety, stress, insecurity, or whatever else you might specifically need. And one of the best parts about BetterHelp is that in addition to offering video and phone sessions with your therapist, you can also do live chat sessions so you don't have to see anyone or even speak over the phone if that's not something that you're comfortable with. And yes, BetterHelp screens all their therapists to ensure that they have experience and that they're certified and that they're licensed. When I decided to start taking therapy, it took me forever to actually find a therapist that worked for me because, I mean, the price of finding a therapist can be expensive and the amount of time that is required can be overwhelming, which is why BetterHelp offers a more affordable alternative to in-person therapy where you can start communicating with your therapist in less than 48 hours. And a huge thank you to BetterHelp because they're giving I Spent a Day with viewers and listeners of the completely uncensored podcast version of the show 10% off their first month at betterhelp.com/padilla. That's betterhelp.com/padilla. Now, back to the world of LARPers. How do you pick your character? Is it really just as simple as this has been something that I've wanted to be?
I'll try and push myself and explore different types of characters or traits that I think are fun. Like your first character is your honest reflection of self.
Really?
Your first character always is.
Who was your first character? This is your first character?
Yeah, she is me, but so femme, so unapologetically woman that I embrace that with my whole being. And in my day-to-day life, I embrace that joy and that gender euphoria of being woman. It makes me happy. I'm not afraid to express that or see, make other people see that part of me. My second character was a mutant, and she basically reflected, because I made her when I was 17, and she reflected how I got bullied a lot growing up. I was fully convinced I was ugly, and I would always be ugly. I just didn't think I was pretty. I didn't think I had the capacity to be beautiful. My second character, Dexter, she was my exploration of, like, she was mutated. She had, like, a disfigured face, and she had, like, really messed up arms because I used to have a lot of acne. And so I would try and cover up my skin and my body with makeup and all these things. And she was probably the closest reflection of how I felt.
When I first started playing, I played for about a year and a half before I went into the Army. So I had already experienced, for real, the very high stakes of the reality of what warfare is and battle and all of that. So I don't gravitate towards the drama so much and towards the loss. There is highs that you will feel when you're in a real high stakes environment that you will never feel again. Getting through combat with your boys and with your guys and with your brothers and sisters after a very high intensity thing, there's no more high than holy shit, we just made that. Did you see that? But the lows aren't worth it. And with LARP, we can take away the lows, you know? And I wish that more young men knew that, you know, you don't have to be the big strapping, you know, square-jawed drill sergeant army guy to be a man. And most of that bullshit is bullshit. You know, I've seen with my own eyes, you know, that chiseled, you know, perfect soldier melt under actual combat conditions when the doughy kid who's, you know, barely making it, almost getting kicked out because he can't run 2 miles in under a set amount of time, face down death for his you know, for us. So just seeing that, you know, anytime those dude bros show up, I'm just like, get the fuck out of here with that, man. That's not what this is for. This is for people to feel a little bit of that high so they know that they don't have to if they don't want to. I remember when it flipped for me from wanting to win to wanting to make winners. You know, picture this guy like 20 years younger, ready, you know, going out there, and I'm like, all right, I'm the first big bad guy. I'm supposed to fight this whole town. I'm ready for it. And I see them, and it's a couple. And they're not ready.
Yeah.
It's their first time that game. Pushed her behind him instinctively, like, just did it. You know, and said, I'll protect you. And then she said, you know, I got you. And she had some of these, right? And she was right behind him.
Yeah.
And she put her hand on his back, and she did, like, healing spells to him while he was fighting me. And they were very bad at the game.
Okay.
They, you know, it was their first time there. They didn't figure out, you know, what you're supposed to do, what you're supposed to say. They didn't say the exact right thing. But, man, that moment, how could I possibly beat them? How could I possibly, like, ruin that moment for them by just being like, well, I was supposed to win. It was supposed to be the rules of the game, and I was going to be the best. No, that moment, it became something that I tried to chase and tried to create in different ways, and it's happened so many times over the past 20 years. To see the range of emotions through these people and being able to touch them more than I ever did from the stage. Ever.
Are there certain elements of LARP that bring out different elements of you that you didn't know were there?
Absolutely. I am really different from Sevius in that, like, Sevius is a lot more of like a maternal instinct than I do. So I get to explore that when I'm Sevius. And then when I'm Zach, like, Zach is a lot more mask, a lot more like them kids than Sevius gets to be. So I think that's one of the ways that I can just sort of, I don't know, I let myself be a little bit more tender as Sevius and a little bit more honest because there's less consequences for it.
When I come onto the set, it is like I am doing role play, not in the sense that I'm being a fake person, but in the sense that I am saying I am a confident person who can do this. And I think in my everyday life outside of this setting, there's a lot of, I don't know if I could do this, I don't know if I could do this. But here, when I come here, it's not a question of if I can do it, because I know that it's like within this confined space and with this confined amount of time that I'm like, I know that I am just going to get through it and I'm going to be able to, at the end of the day, feel accomplished.
Yeah, and that confidence and the support, like, in this space, that's the kind of stuff that's a good bleep. Even if I feel like things in real life are getting a little too complicated, I know, like, Sevius has handled, you know, 10 bloodied bodies and, like, 6 bandages between them. And nobody died. Like, she just handled it, which means I handled it. I can handle whatever this is.
By my voice, stun! One. One. Isn't that cheating?
No.
That feels like cheating. I just killed you.
Well, here's the thing. I'm not a fighter.
So if you found yourself in that position, it would probably be because it was on purpose for a story element.
Yeah, or my character being foolish.
So you would want that.
Yeah.
You would want to die if you chose for that situation to unfold.
Yeah, if I want combat, it's because my character like is actively seeking it out. I don't look like someone who fights. I don't talk to people that fight. It's because I want the smoke for some like dramatic reason.
I think from the outside, it would look silly because you're like, it was, you fudged the rules and then you killed them and they're dead. That's messed up. That's not fair. But in reality, you wanted it to happen because it's part of the story. It's part of your character arc.
Yes.
I feel like it's much more clear to me that LARPing, even though you are playing a character, most times it stems from somewhere really within you.
Yeah.
Right? And it gives you a safe environment, or safer environment,
yes,
to experience these emotions. And it also can empower you to take charge in knowing what it is that you want to deal with emotionally, and also empowers you to set boundaries and know when it feels okay to move through that.
Exactly.
Mm.
Exactly. This increases your awareness.
I'll be real with you though, there are LARPs that have adult content in them. That have like... Yeah, they do. They
Oh,
yeah.
Shit. I didn't
also,
know that.
LARPers, like, LARPers.
Oh, yeah? Because well, because they're not afraid to be who they think that they feel on the inside needs to come out.
Exactly.
Say hello for a second.
And that's a little hi.
Yeah, hi, it's me. I'm in you.
But, like... I mean, like, yeah, you're not wrong. Like, it's always our funniest joke in our community is how we're always depicted in media, like, we're a bunch of losers, sexless virgins.
Yeah!
No, so far the opposite. I can't even begin, dude.
More sex.
Yeah.
Than non-LARPers have, probably.
Honestly, yeah. Well, you get a bunch of horny nerds.
Yeah.
Like, hot horny nerds in one place. What do you think is gonna happen?
Yeah.
You think they're gonna be like, nah?
They're like, just putting on my elf ears.
Yeah.
I think you know what that means.
And, like, don't get me wrong. It's not like... like sex at LARP, especially in the US, is a very touchy topic. But nothing ever happens without somebody's consent, period.
Yeah.
Like in LARP, it is extremely consent based. And like there are ways that you can do check-ins that don't necessarily break the character. So like if we were LARPing and let's say you were like screaming at me, just like getting in my face and in an argument, and I wanted the scene to continue, but I need you to cool down, like I need you to back off a little bit, I could say, oh mother. And
is that your code word?
Yeah, and oh mother would be the code word for you to go, okay, she doesn't want me to stop yelling at her, but I need to pull it back a little bit.
Oh, keep going, but softer, gentler.
Exactly.
Okay, should we do an example here?
Yeah, so I'm gonna aggress towards you, ready?
Yeah.
You fool, you really, really think that I would ever, ever, ever fall for somebody like you?
Oh mother.
I would never fall for somebody like you. You are an aggressive, silly man. And like, so you see, like, I lowered the tone of my voice.
Yeah, you took a step back. Are you a pro LARPer? Are you considered pro?
Yes, I am a pro LARPer.
How do you get that label of pro LARPer?
It was given to me by others.
Okay.
What
did you do to others for them to call you a pro LARPer?
Some of these megacorps, like Microsoft and Google and all these like big tech companies will use LARP to teach their employees teamwork skills, empathy, and whatnot, until they hire LARP companies to produce those LARPs. And so I was hired to be the lead character in this corporate LARP for this company. And we had to film like this little movie that was then going to be sent out to
Did you LARP with Bill Gates?
No, I had not yet. Call me Bill. But like I went there and it was a paid job. Like they paid for my flight.
Yeah.
I made a good chunk of change off of it. And then I remember we were all sitting around a table and I was like, huh, this is like a professional LARP gig. And they're like, I guess you can call yourself a professional LARPer.
And you're like, I will.
I am the world's first professional LARPer.
What is it about LARPing that brings you the most joy?
It's the people.
Yeah.
It's the stories that I get. Oh, sorry.
It's okay.
It's the stories that I've gotten to create with people that were once strangers, that have since become people I love, people that I am so happy to have in my life. It has completely changed myself and my world because of the beautiful human beings that made the decision to maybe be a little silly and dress up in the woods and make really cool stories. And I'm very thankful for every person I've ever interacted with that has helped me play my characters, and I have been able to help them play theirs. I think the people is, it's what I look forward to most when I go. It's not just, oh, I get to dress up as this character. It's, oh, I get to see this person, and we're gonna play this plot we've been building for like 6 months, and it's finally gonna come to a head, and it's gonna be sick, bro. And it's like, that's what I look forward to every time. It's the people. If you have a problem with them off game, talk to them off game. Deal with it like adults out of the game. Don't use the game as a way to express whatever you're feeling.
Oh, that's, you mean don't go there and be passive aggressive?
Yeah, don't go there and use LARP to be passive aggressive. See, I just killed your
friend. Wow, the passive aggressiveness that I'm witnessing right here. Wow, you know you can just hit me with that loaf over the head if you have something to say.
I know.